you, pray you, a word. Do you not follow the young Lord Paris?
Aye, sir, when he goes before me.
You depend upon him, I mean.
Sir, I do depend upon the Lord.
You depend upon a noble gentleman. I must needs praise him.
The Lord be praised.
You know me, do you not?
Faith, sir, superficially.
A friend, know me better. I am the Lord Pandarus.
I hope I shall know your honour better.
I do desire it.
You are in the state of grace?
Grace? Not so, friend. Honour and lordship are my titles. What music is this?
I do but partly know, sir. It is music in parts.
Know you the musicians?
Wholly, sir.
Who play they to?
To the hearers, sir.
At whose pleasure, friend?
At mine, sir, and theirs that love music.
Command, I mean, friend.
Who shall I command, sir?
Friend, we understand not one another. I am too courtly and thou art too cunning. At whose request do these men play?
Ah, that's to it indeed, sir. Marry, sir, at the request of Paris, my lord, who is there in person. With him, the mortal Venus, the heart-blood of beauty, love's indivisible soul.
Who, my cousin Cressida?
No, sir, Helen. Could you not find out that by her attributes?
It would seem, fellow, that thou hast not seen the Lady Cressida. I come to speak with Paris from the Prince Troilus. I will make a complimental assault upon him, for my business seethes.
Sodden business. There's a stewed phrase indeed.
Fair be to you, my lord, and to all this fair company. Fair desires, in all fair measure, fairly guide them. Especially to you, fair queen. Fair thoughts be your fair pillow.
Dear lord, you are full of fair words.
You speak your fair pleasure, sweet queen. Fair prince, here is good broken music.
You have broke it, cousin, and by my life, you shall make it whole again. You shall piece it out with a piece of your performance. Nell, he is full of harmony. Oh,
truly, lady, no.
Oh, sir.
Rude, in sooth. In good sooth, very rude.
Well said, my lord. Well, you say so in fits.
I have business to my lord, dear queen. My lord, will you vouchsafe me a word?
Oh, nay, this shall not hedge us out. We'll hear you sing, certainly.
Well, sweet queen, you are pleasant with me. But marry thus, my lord. My dear lord and most esteemed friend, your brother Troilus.
My lord Pandarus. Honey, sweet lord.
Go to, sweet queen, go to. Commends himself most affectionately to you.
You shall not bob us out of our melody. If you do, our melancholy upon your head.
Sweet queen, that's a sweet queen, i' faith.
And to make a sweet lady sad is a sour offence.
Nay, that shall not serve your turn. That shall it not, in truth, la. Nay, I care not for such words. No, no. And my lord, he desires you that if the king call for him at supper, you will make his excuse.
My lord Pandarus.
What says my sweet queen, my very, very sweet queen?
What exploits in hand? Where's Supsy tonight?
Nay, but my lord.
What says my sweet queen? My cousin will fall out with you. You must not know where he sups.
Oh, I'll lay my life with my disposer, Cressida.
No, no, no such matter. You are wide. Come, your disposer is sick.
Well, I'll make excuse.
Aye, good, my lord. Why should you say Cressida? No, your poor disposer's sick.
I spy.
You spy? What do you spy? Come, give me an instrument. Now, sweet queen.
Why, this is kindly done.
My niece is horribly in love with the thing you have, sweet queen.
She shall have it, my lord. If it be not my lord Paris.
He? Oh, no, she'll none of him. They two are twain.
Oh, falling in after falling out may make them three.
Come, come, I'll hear no more of this. I'll sing you a song now.
Aye, prithee now. By my troth, sweet lord, thou hast a fine forehead.
Aye, you may.
Let thy song be love. This love will undo us all. Oh, Cupid, Cupid, Cupid.
Love, aye, that it shall, i' faith.
Aye, good now. Love, love, nothing but love.
In good truth, it begins so. Oh, love, love, nothing but love still more. For, oh, love's bow shoots back and doe. The shaft confounds not that it wounds, but tickles still the sore. Those lovers cry, oh, they die, yet that which seems the wound to kill doth turn, to ha, ha, he, so dying love lives still. A while, but ha, 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 groans out for ha, ha, ha.
In love, i'faith, to the very tip of the nose.
He eats nothing but doves, love, and that breeds hot blood. And hot blood begets hot thoughts, and hot thoughts beget hot deeds. And hot deeds is love.
Is this the generation of love? Hot blood, hot thoughts, and hot deeds? Why, they are vipers. Is love a generation of vipers? Sweet lord, who's afield today?
Hector, Deiphobus, Helenus, Antenor, and all the gallantry of Troy. I would fain have armed today, but my Nell would not have it so. How chance my brother Troilus went not?
He hangs the lip at something. You know all, Lord Pandarus.
Not I, honey sweet queen. I long to hear how they sped today. You remember your brother's excuse.
To a hair.
Farewell, sweet queen.
Commend me to your niece.
I will, sweet queen.
They come from the field. Let us to Priam's hall to greet the warriors. Sweet Helen, I must woo you to help unarm our Hector. His stubborn buckles, with these your white enchanting fingers touched, shall more obey than to the edge of steel or force of Greekish sinews. You shall do more than all the island kings. Disarm great Hector.
'Twill make us proud to be his servant, Paris. Yea, what he shall receive of us in duty gives us more palm in beauty than we have, yea, overshines ourselves.
Sweet, above thought, I love thee.
How now? Where's thy master? At my cousin Cressida's?
No, sir. He stays for you to conduct him thither.
Oh, here he comes. How now? How now?
Sirrah, walk off.
Have you seen my cousin?
No, Pandarus. I stalk about her door like a strange soul upon the Stygian banks, staying for wafting. Oh, be thou my Charon, and give me swift transportance to those fields where I may wallow in the lily beds proposed for the deserver. Oh, gentle Pander, from Cupid's shoulder pluck his painted wings and fly with me to Cressid.
Walk here in the orchard. I'll bring her straight.
I'm giddy. Expectation whirls me round. Imaginary relish is so sweet that it enchants my sense. What will it be when that the watery palate tastes indeed love's thrice repurid nectar? Death, I fear me. Swooning distraction, or some joy too fine, too subtle, potent, tuned too sharp in sweetness for the capacity of my ruder power. I fear it much. I do fear besides that I shall lose distinction in my joys, as doth a battle when they charge on heaps the enemy flying.
She's making her ready. She'll come straight. You must be witty now. She does so blush and fetches her wind so short as if she were frayed with a sprite. I'll fetch her. It is the prettiest villain. She fetches her breath as short as a new-tailed sparrow.
Even such a passion doth embrace my bosom. My heart beats thicker than a feverous pulse, and all my powers do their bestowing lose, like vassalage at unawares encountering the eye of majesty.
Come, come, what need you blush? Shame's a baby. Here she is now. Swear the oaths now to her that you have sworn to me. What, are you gone again? You must be watched ere you be made tame, must you? Come your ways, come your ways. And you draw backward, we'll put you in the fills. Why do you not speak to her? Come, draw this curtain and let's see your picture. Alas, the day, how loath you are to offend daylight. And 'twere dark, you'd close sooner. So, rub on and kiss the mistress. How now, a kiss in Fee Farm? Build there, carpenter, the air is sweet. Nay, you shall fight your hearts out ere I part you. The falcon is the tercel for all the ducks in the river. Go to, go to.
You have bereft me of all words, lady.
Words pay no debts. Give her deeds. But she'll believe you the deeds, too, if she call your activity in question. What? Billing again? Here's in witness whereof the parties interchangeably. Come in, come in. I'll go get a fire.
Will you walk in, my lord?
Oh, Cressida. How often have I wished me thus?
Wished, my lord? The gods grant. Oh, my lord.
What should they grant? What makes this pretty abruption? What too curious dreg espies my sweet lady in the fountain of our love?
More dregs than water, if my fears have eyes.
Fears make devils of cherubims. They never see truly.
Blind fear that seeing reason leads finds safer footing than blind reason stumbling without fear. To fear the worst oft cures the worst.
Oh, let my lady apprehend no fear. In all Cupid's pageant there is presented no monster.
Nor nothing monstrous, neither?
Nothing but our undertakings. When we vow to weep seas, live in fires, eat rocks, tame tigers, thinking it harder for our mistress to devise imposition enough than for us to undergo any difficulty imposed. This is the monstrosity in love, lady. But the will is infinite, and the execution confined. That the desire is boundless, and the act a slave to limit.
They say all lovers swear more performance than they are able, and yet reserve an ability that they never perform. Vowing more than the perfection of 10, and discharging less than the 10th part of 1. They that have the voice of lions and the act of hares, are they not monsters?
Are they such? Such are not we. Praise us as we are tasted. Allow us as we prove. Our head shall go bare till merit crown it. No perfection in reversion shall have a praise in present. We will not name desert before his birth, and being born, his addition shall be humble. Few words to fair faith. Troilus shall be such to Cressid as what envy can say worse shall be a mock for his truth. And what truth can speak truest? Not truer than Troilus.
Will you walk in, my lord?
What? Blushing still? Have you not done talking yet?
Well, uncle, what folly I commit, I dedicate to you.
I thank you for that. If my lord get a boy of you, you'll give him me. Be true to my lord. If he flinch, chide me for it.
You know now your hostages. Your uncle's word and my firm faith.
Nay, I'll give my word for her, too. Our kindred, though they be long ere they are wooed, they're constant being won. They are burrs, I can tell you. They'll stick where they are thrown.
Boldness comes to me now and brings me heart. Prince Troilus, I have loved you night and day for many weary months.
Why was my Cressid then so hard to win?
Hard to seem won, but I was won, my lord, with the first glance that ever... Pardon me. If I confess much, you will play the tyrant. I love you now, but not till now so much, but I might master it. In faith, I lie, and my thoughts were like unbridled children, grown too headstrong for their mother. See, we fools, why have I blabbed? Who shall be true to us when we are so unsecret to ourselves? But though I loved you well, I wooed you not. And yet, good faith, I wished myself a man, or that we women had men's privilege of speaking first. Sweet boy, bid me hold my tongue, for in this rapture I shall surely speak the thing I shall repent. See,
See, your silence, cunning in dumbness, from my weakness draws my very soul of counsel. Stop my mouth.
And shall, albeit sweet music issues thence.
Oh, to your faith.
My lord, I do beseech you, pardon me. It was not my purpose thus to beg a kiss. I am ashamed. Oh, heavens, what have I done? For this time will I take my leave, my lord.
Your leave, sweet Cressida?
Leave? And you take leave till tomorrow morning?
Pray you, content you.
What offends you, lady?
Sir, mine own company.
You cannot shun yourself.
Let me go and try. I have a kind of self resides with you, but an unkind self that itself will leave to be another's fool. I would be gone. Where is my wit? I know not what I speak.
Well, know they what they speak that speak so wisely.
Perchance, my lord, I show more craft than love, and fell so roundly to a large confession to angle for your thoughts. But you are wise, or else you love not. For to be wise and love exceeds man's might. That dwells with gods above.
Oh, that I thought it could be in a woman. As if it can, I will presume in you. To feed for aye her lamp and flame of love, to keep her constancy in plight and youth, outliving beauty's outward, with a mind that doth renew swifter than blood decays. Or that persuasion could but thus convince me that my integrity and truth to you might be affronted with the match and weight of such a winnowed purity in love, how were I then uplifted? But alas, I am as true as truth's simplicity, and simpler than the infancy of truth.
In that I'll war with you.
Oh, virtuous fight, when right with right wars, who shall be most right? True swains in love shall in the world to come approve their truths by Troilus. When their rhymes, full of protest, of oath, and big compare, want similes, truth tired with iteration, as true as steel, as plantage to the moon, as sun to day, as turtle to her mate, as iron to adamant, as earth to the center, yet after all comparisons of truth, as truth's authentic author to be cited, as true as Troilus shall crown up the verse and sanctify the numbers.
Prophet may you be. If I be false, or swerve a hair from truth, when time is old and hath forgot itself, when water drops have worn the stones of Troy, and blind oblivion swallowed cities up, and mighty states, Caractolus, are grated to dusty nothing, yet let memory from false to false, among false maids in love, upbraid my falsehood. When they've said as false, as air, as water, wind, or sandy earth, as fox to lamb, or wolf to heifer's calf, pard to the hind, or stepdame to her son, yea, let them say to stick the heart of falsehood, as false as Cressid.
Go to, a bargain made. Seal it, seal it. I'll be the witness. Here I hold your hand, here my cousin's. If ever you prove false one to another, since I have taken such pains to bring you together, let all pitiful goers between be called to the world's end after my name. Call them all Pandarus. Let all constant men be Troiluses, all false women Cressids, and all brokers between Pandarus. Say Amen.
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 Amen. Whereupon, I will show you a chamber with a bed. Which bed, because it shall not speak of your pretty encounters, press it to death. Away. And Cupid grant all tongue-tied maidens here, bed, chamber, pander, to provide this gear.
Princes, for the service I have done, the advantage of the time prompts me aloud to call for recompense. Appear it to your minds that through the sight I bear in things to come, I have abandoned Troy, left my possession, incurred a traitor's name, exposed myself from certain and possessed conveniences to doubtful fortunes, sequestering me from all that time, acquaintance, custom, and condition made tame and most familiar to my nature. And here to do you service and become as new into the world, strange, unacquainted. I do beseech you, as in way of taste, to give me now a little benefit out of those many registered in promise, which, you say, live to come in my behalf.
What wouldst thou of us, Trojan? Make demand.
You have a Trojan prisoner called Antino, yesterday took. Troy holds him very dear. Often have you thanks, therefore, desired my Cressid in right great exchange, whom Troy has still denied. But this Antino, I know, is such a rest in their affairs that their negotiations all must slack, wanting his manage. And they will almost give us a prince of blood, a son of Priam, in change for him. Let him be sent, great princes, and he shall buy my daughter, and her presence shall quite strike off all service I have done in most accepted pay.
Let Diomed bear him, and bring us Cressid hither. Calchas shall have what he requests of us. Good Diomed, furnish you fairly for this interchange. Withal, bring word if Hector will tomorrow be answered in his challenge. Ajax is ready.
This shall I undertake, and 'tis a burden which I am proud to bear.
Achilles stands in the entrance of his tent. Please it our general pass strangely by him, as if he were forgot. And princes all, lay negligent and loose regard upon him. I will come last. 'Tis like he'll question me why such unplausive eyes are bent on him. If so, I have derision midsonable to use between your strangeness and his pride, which his own will shall have desire to drink. It may do good. Pride hath no other glass to show itself but pride. For supple knees feed arrogance, and are the proud man's fees.
We'll execute your purpose, and put on a form of strangeness as we pass along. So do each lord, and either greet him not, or else disdainfully, which shall shake him more than if not looked on. I will lead the way.
What? Comes the general to speak with me? You know my mind. I'll fight no more against Troy.
What says Achilles? Would he aught with us?
Would you, my lord, aught with the general?
No.
Nothing, my lord.
The better.
Good day, good day. How do you? How do you? What? Does the cuckold scorn me?
How now, Patroclus?
Good morrow, Ajax.
Huh?
Good morrow.
Aye, and good next day, too.
What mean these fellows? Know they not, Achilles?
They pass by strangely. They were used to bend, to send their smiles before them to Achilles, to come as humbly as they used to creep to holy altars.
What? Am I poor of late? 'Tis certain, greatness, once fallen out with fortune, must fall out with men too. What the declined is, he shall as soon read in the eyes of others as feel in his own fall. For men, like butterflies, show not their mealy wings but to the summer. And not a man for being simply man hath any honor, but honor for those honors that are without him, as place, riches, and favor, prizes of accident as oft as merit, which, when they fall, as being slippery standers, the love that leaned on them, as slippery too, doth one pluck down another, and together die in the fall. But 'tis not so with me. Fortune and I are friends. I do enjoy at ample point all that I did possess, save these men's looks, who do, methinks, find out something not worth in me such rich beholding as they have often given. Here is Ulysses. I'll interrupt his reading. How now, Ulysses?
Now, great Thetis' son,
what are you reading?
A strange fellow here writes me. That man, how dearly ever parted, how much in having or without or in, cannot make boast to have that which he hath, nor feels not what he owes, but by reflection, as when his virtues, shining upon others, heat them, and they retort that heat again to the first giver.
This is not strange, Ulysses. The beauty that is born here in the face, the bearer knows not, but commends itself to others' eyes. Nor doth the eye itself, that most pure spirit of sense, behold itself, not going from itself, but eye to eye opposed, salutes each other with each other's form. For speculation turns not to itself till it hath travelled, and is mirrored there where it may see itself. This is not strange at all.
I do not strain at the position. It is familiar. But the author's drift, who in his circumstance expressly proves that no man is the lord of anything, though in and of him there be much consisting, till he communicate his parts to others. Nor doth he of himself know them for aught, till he behold them formed in the applause where they're extended. Who, like an arch, reverberate the voice again, or like a gate of steel fronting the sun, receives and renders back his figure and his heat. I was much wrapped in this, and apprehended here immediately the unknown Ajax. Heavens, what a man is there! A very horse that has he knows not what. Nature, what things there are, most abject in regard and dear in use. What things again most dear in the esteem and poor in worth. Now shall we see tomorrow an act that very chance doth throw upon him. Ajax, renowned. Oh, heavens, what some men do while some men leave to do. How some men creep in skittish fortune's hall while others play the idiots in her eyes. How one man eats into another's pride while pride is fasting in his wantonness. To see these Grecian lords. Why, even already they clap the lubber Ajax on the shoulder as if his foot were on brave Hector's breast and great Troy is shrinking.
I do believe it, for they've passed me by as misers do by beggars. Neither gave to me good word nor look. What? Are my deeds forgot?
Time hath, my lord, a wallet at his back, wherein he puts arms for oblivion, a great-sized monster of ingratitude. Those scraps are good deeds past, which are devoured as fast as they are made, forgot as soon as done. Perseverance, dear my lord, keeps honor bright. The have-done is to hang quite out of fashion like a rusty mail in monumental mockery. Take the instant way, for honor travels in a strait so narrow where one but goes abreast. Keep then the path, for emulation hath a thousand sons that one by one pursue. If you give way or hedge aside from the direct forthright, like to an entered tide, they all rush by and leave you hindmost. Or like a gallant horse fallen in first rank, lie there for pavement to the abject rear, or run and trampled on. Then what they do in present, though less than yours in past, must o'ertop yours. But time is like a fashionable host, that slightly shakes his parting guest by the hand, and with his arms outstretched as he would fly, grasps in the comer. Welcome ever smiles, and farewell goes out, sigh. Oh, let not virtue seek remuneration for the thing it was. For beauty, wit, high birth, vigor of bone, desert in service, love, friendship, charity, are subject all to envious and calumniating time. One touch of nature makes the whole world kin, that all with one consent praise newborn gauds, though they are made and molded of things past, and give to dust that is a little gilt, more lord than gilt or dusty. The present eye praises the present object. Then marvel not, thou great and complete man, that all the Greeks begin to worship Ajax, since things in motion sooner catch the eye than what not stirs. The cry went once on thee, and still it might, and yet it may again, if thou wouldst not entomb thyself alive and case thy reputation in thy tent. Whose glorious deeds but in these fields of late made emulous missions amongst the gods themselves,
and drave great Mars to faction.
Of this, my privacy, I have strong reasons.
Against your privacy, the reasons are more potent and heroical.
It is known, Achilles, that you are in love with one of Priam's daughters.
Huh? Known?
Is that a wonder? The providence that's in a watchful state knows almost every grain of Pluto's gold, finds a bottom in the uncomprehensive deeps, keeps place with thought, and almost like the gods does thoughts unveil in their dumb cradles. There is a mystery with whom relation durst never meddle in the soul of state, which hath an operation more divine than breath or pen can give expression to. All the commerce that you have had with Troy perfectly is ours as yours, my lord. And better would it fit Achilles much to throw down Hector than Polyxena. But it must grieve young Pyrrhus now at home, when fame shall in our island sound her trump, and all the Greekish girls shall tripping sing, great Hector's sister did Achilles win, but our great Ajax bravely beat down him. Farewell, my lord. I, as your lover, speak. The fool slides o'er the ice that you should break.
To this effect, Achilles, have I moved you. A woman impudent and mannish grown is not more loathed than an effeminate man in time of action. I stand condemned for this. They think my little stomach to the war and your great love to me restrains you thus. Sweet, rouse yourself, and the weak, wanton Cupid shall from your neck unloose his amorous fold, and like a dewdrop from the lion's mane be shook to air.
Shall Ajax fight with Hector?
Aye, and perhaps receive much honor by him.
I see my reputation is at stake. My fame is shrewdly gone.
Oh, then beware. Those wounds heal ill that men do give themselves. A mission to do what is necessary seals a commission to a blank of danger, and danger like an ague subtly taints, even then when we sit idly in the sun.
Go! Call Thersites hither, sweet Patroclus. I'll send the fool to Ajax, and desire him to invite the Trojan lords after the combat to see us here unarmed. I have a woman's longing, an appetite that I am sick withal, to see great Hector in his weeds of peace, to talk with him, and to behold his visage even to my full of view. A labor saved.
A wonder!
What?
Ajax goes up and down the field asking for himself.
How so?
He must fight singly tomorrow with Hector, and is so prophetically proud of an heroical cudgeling that he raves in saying nothing.
How can that be?
Why, he stalks up and down like a peacock, astride and astare, ruminates like a hostess that hath no arithmetic but her brain to set down her reckoning, bites his lip with a politic regard, as who should say, there were wit in this head, and 'twould out. And so there is, but it lies as coldly in him as fire in a flint, which will not show without knocking. The man's undone forever, for if Hector break not his neck at the combat, he'll break it himself in vain glory. He knows not me. I said, good morrow, Ajax. And he replies, thanks, Agamemnon. What think you of this man that takes me for the general? He's grown a very landfish, languageless, a monster. A plague of opinion, a man may wear it on both sides like a leather jerkin.
Thou must be my ambassador to him, Thersites.
Why? Why, he'll answer nobody. He professes not answering. Speaking is for beggars. He wears his tongue in his arms. I will put on his presence. Let Patroclus make his demands to me. You shall see the pageant of Ajax.
To him, Patroclus. Tell him I humbly desire the valiant Ajax to invite the most valorous Hector to come unarmed to my tent, and to procure safe conduct for his person of the magnanimous and most illustrious 6 or 7 times honored captain general of the Grecian army, Agamemnon, etc., etc. Do this.
Jove bless great Ajax. I come from the worthy Achilles.
Ah!
who most humbly desires you to invite Hector to his tent. And to procure safe conduct from Agamemnon.
Agamemnon?
Aye, my lord. What say you to it?
God be with you, with all my heart.
Your answer, sir.
If tomorrow be a fair day, by 11 o'clock it will go one way or the other. Howsoever, he shall pay for me ere he has me.
Your answer, sir.
Fare you well, with all my heart.
Why, but he is not in this tune, is he?
No, but he's out of tune at that. What music will be in him when Hector has knocked out his brains, I know not. But I am sure none, unless the fiddler Apollo gets his sinews to make catlings on.
Come, thou shalt bear a letter to him straight.
Let me carry another to his horse, for that's the more capable creature.
My mind is troubled, like a fountain stirred, and I myself see not the bottom of it.
Would the fountain of your mind were clear again, that I might water an ass at it. I had rather be a tick in a sheep than such a valiant ignorance.
See ho! Who is that there? It is the Lord Aeneas.
Is the prince there in person? Had I so good occasion to lie long as you, Prince Paris, nothing but heavenly business should rob my bedmate of my company.
That's my mind, too. Good morrow, Lord Aeneas.
A valiant Greek, Aeneas. Take his hand. Witness the process of your speech, wherein you told how Diomed a whole week by days did haunt you in the field.
Health to you, valiant sir, during all question of the gentle truce. But when I meet you armed, as black defiance as heart can think or courage execute.
The one and other Diomed embraces. Our bloods are now in car, and so long, health. But when contention and occasion meet, by Jove, I'll play the hunter for thy life with all my force, pursuit, and policy.
And thou shalt hunt a lion that will fly with his face backward. Inhumane gentleness, welcome to try. Now, by Anchises' life, welcome indeed. By Venus' hand, I swear no man alive can love in such a sort the thing he means to kill more excellently.
We sympathize. Jove, let Aeneas live. If to my sword his fate be not the glory, 1,000 complete courses of the sun. But in my emulous honor, let him die with every joint a wound, and that tomorrow.
We know each other well.
We do, and long to know each other worse.
This is the most spiteful, gentle greeting, the noblest hateful love that e'er I heard of. What business, Lord, so early?
I was sent for to the king, but why, I know not.
Oh, his purpose meets you. 'Twas to bring this Greek to Calchas' house, and there to render him for the infreed Antino the fair Cressid. Let's have your company, or if you please, haste there before us.
I constantly do think, or rather call my thought a certain knowledge, my brother Troilus lodges there tonight. Rouse him, and give him note of our approach, with the whole quality wherefore. I fear we shall be much unwelcome.
That I assure you. Troilus had rather Troy were born to Greece than Cressid born from Troy.
There is no help. The bitter disposition of the time will have it so.
On, Lord, we'll follow you.
Good morrow, all.
And tell me, noble Diomed, faith, tell me true, even in the soul of sound good fellowship, who in your thoughts merits fair Helen most? Myself or Menelaus?
Both alike. He merits well to have her that doth seek her, not making any scruple of her soilure, with such a hell of pain and world of charge. And you as well to keep her that defend her, not palating the taste of her dishonor, with such a costly loss of wealth and friends. He, like a puling cuckold, would drink up the lees and dregs of a flat tamed peace. You, like a lecher, out of whorish loins, are pleased to breed out your inheritors. Both merits poised, each ways nor less nor more, but he as he, the heavier for a whore.
You are too bitter to your countrywoman.
She's bitter to her country. Hear me, Paris. For every false drop in her bawdy veins, a Grecian's life hath sunk. For every scruple of her contaminated carrion weight, a Trojan hath been slain. Since she could speak, she has not given so many good words breath, as for her Greeks and Trojans suffered death.
Fair Diomed, you do as Chapman do. Dispraise the thing that you desire to buy. But we in silence hold this virtue well. We'll but commend what we intend to sell. Here lies our way.
Dear, trouble not yourself. The morn is cold.
And sweet, my lord, I'll call mine uncle down. He shall unbolt the gate.
Trouble him not. To bed, to bed. Sleep lull those pretty eyes, and give a soft attachment to thy senses as infants empty of all thought.
Good morrow, then.
Prithee now, to bed.
Are you aweary of me?
Oh, Cressida. But the busy day, waked by the lark, hath roused the ribald crows, and dreaming night will hide our joys no longer. I would not from thee.
Night hath been too brief.
Beshrew the witch. With venomous wight she stays as tediously as hell, but flies the grasps of love with wings more momentary swift than thought. You will catch cold and curse me.
Prithee, tarry. You men will never tarry. Oh, foolish Cressid. I might have still held off, and then you would have tarried. There's one up.
What's all the doors open here?
'Tis your uncle.
Oh, a pestilence on him. Now he will be mocking. I shall have such a lie.
How now, how now? How go, maidenheads? Here, you maid, where's my cousin Cressid?
Oh, go hang yourself, you naughty mocking uncle. You bring me to do, and then you flout me, too.
To do what? To do what? Let her say what. What have I brought you to do?
Oh, come, beshrew your heart. You'll ne'er be good nor suffer others.
Alas, poor wretch. A poor Capocchia has not slept tonight. Oh. Would he not a naughty man let it sleep? A bugbear take him.
Did I not tell you? Woody were knocked to the head. Who's that at door? Good uncle, go and see. My lord, come you again into my chamber. You smile and mock me as if I meant naughtily. Come, you're deceived. I think of no such thing. How earnestly they knock. Pray you come in. I would not for half Troy have you seen here.
Who's there? What's the matter? Will you beat down the door? How now? What's the matter?
Good morrow, lord. Good morrow.
Who's there? Lord Aeneas? By my troth, I knew you not. What news with you so early?
Is not Prince Troilus here?
Here? What should he do here?
Come, he is here, my lord. Do not deny him. It doth import him much to speak with me.
Is he here, say you? 'Tis more than I know, I'll be sworn. For my own part, I came in late. What should he do here?
Oh, nay, then. Come, you'll do him wrong, are you aware? You'll be so true to him to be false to him. Do not you know of him, but yet go fetch him hither. Go.
How now? What's the matter?
My lord, I scarce have leisure to salute you. My matter is so rash. There is at hand Paris, your brother, and Deiphobus, the Grecian Diomed, and our Antenor delivered to us. And for him forthwith, ere the first sacrifice, within this hour, we must give up to Diomede's hand the Lady Cressida.
Is it so concluded?
By Priam and the general state of Troy. They are at hand and ready to effect it.
How my achievements mock me. I will go meet them. And my lord Aeneas, we met by chance. You did not find me here.
Good, my lord. The secrets of neighbor Pandar have not more gift in taciturnity.
Is possible. No sooner got but lost. The devil take Antenor. The young prince will go mad. A plague upon Antenor. I would they'd broke his neck.
Ah, now, what's the matter? Who was here?
Oh.
Why sigh you so profoundly? Where's my lord? Gone? Tell me, sweet uncle, what's the matter?
Would I were as deep under the earth as I am above.
Oh, the gods. What's the matter?
Prithee, get thee in. Would thou hadst ne'er been born, I knew thou wouldst be his death. Oh, poor gentleman. A plague upon Antioch.
Good uncle, I beseech you, on my knees, I beseech you, what's the matter?
Thou must be gone, wench, thou must be gone. Thou art changed for Antioch. Thou must to thy father and be gone from Troilus. Will be his death, will be his bane, he cannot bear it.
Oh, you immortal God. I will not go.
Thou must.
I will not, uncle. I have forgot my father. I know no touch of consanguinity, no kin, no love, no blood, no soul so near me as the sweet Troilus. Oh, you gods divine, make Cressid's name the very crown of falsehood if ever she leave Troilus. Time, force, and death do to this body what extremes you can. But the strong base and building of my love is as the very center of the earth, drawing all things to it. I'll go in and weep.
Do.
Tear my bright hair and scratch my praised cheeks. Crack my clear voice with sobs and break my heart with sounding Troilus. I will not go from Troy.
It is great morning, and the hour prefixed for her delivery to this valiant Greek comes fast upon us. Good my brother Troilus, tell you the lady what she is to do, and haste her to the purpose.
Walk into her house. I'll bring her to the Grecian presently. And to his hand, when I deliver her, think it an altar, and thy brother Troilus a priest, there offering to it his own heart.
I know what 'tis to love, and would, as I shall pity, I could help. Please you walk in, my lords.
Be moderate.
Why tell you me of moderation? The grief is fine, full, perfect, that I taste, and violenteth in a sense as strong as that which causeth it. How can I moderate it? If I could temporize with my affection, or brew it to a weak and colder palate, the like allayment could I give my grief. My love admits no qualifying dross, no more my grief in such a precious loss.
Here he comes. Oh. Sweet duck.
Oh, Troilus.
What a pair of spectacles is here. Let me embrace too. Oh, heart, as the goodly saying is. Oh, heart, oh, heavy heart, why sighst thou without breaking? Where he answers again. Because thou canst not ease thy smart by friendship nor by speaking. There was never a truer rhyme. Let us cast away nothing, for we may live to have need of such a verse. We see it. Oh, now, lambs.
Cressid, I love thee in so strained a purity that the blessed gods as angry with my fancy, more bright in zeal than the devotion which cold lips blow to their deities, take thee from me.
Have the gods envy?
Aye, it is too plain a case.
And is it true that I must go from Troy?
Hateful truth.
What, and from Troilus too?
From Troy and Troilus.
Oh, is it possible?
Suddenly,
where injury of chance puts back leave-taking, jostles roughly by all time of pause, rudely beguiles our lips of all rejoinder, forcibly prevents our locked embraces, strangles our dear vows even in the birth of our own laboring breath. We two, that with so many thousand sighs did buy each other, must poorly sell ourselves with the rude brevity and discharge of one. Injurious time, now with a robber's haste, crams his rich thievery up, he knows not how, as many farewells as be stars in heaven, with distinct breath and consigned kisses to them, he fumbles up into a looser dew, and scants us with a single famished kiss, distasted with the salt of broken tears.
My lord, is the lady ready?
God, you are called. Some say the genius so cries, come to him that instantly must die. Bid them have patience, she shall come anon.
Where are my tears? Rain to lay this wind, or my heart will be blown up by the roof.
I must vent to the Grecians.
No remedy.
A woeful Cressid amongst the merry Greeks. When shall we see again?
Hear me, my love. Be thou the true of heart.
Aye, true. Ah, now what wicked deem is this?
Nay, we must use expostulation kindly, for it is parting from us. I speak not, be thou true as fearing thee. For I will throw my glove to death himself, that there's no maculation in thy heart. But be thou true, say I, to fashion in my sequent protestation. Be thou true, and I will see thee.
Oh, you shall be exposed, my lord, to dangers as infinite as imminent. But I'll be true.
And I'll grow friend with danger. Wear this sleeve.
And you this glove. When shall I see you?
I will corrupt the Grecian sentinels to give thee nightly visitation. But yet be true.
Oh, heavens, be true again.
Hear why I speak it, love. The Grecian youths are full of quality. They're loving, well-composed with gifts of nature, and flowing o'er with arts and exercise, how novelties may move and parts with person. Alas, a kind of godly jealousy, which I beseech you call a virtuous sin, makes me afeard.
Oh, heavens, you love me not.
Die, I a villain, then. In this I do not call your faith in question, so mainly as my merit. I cannot sing, nor heal the high levolt, nor sweeten talk, nor play at subtle games. Fair virtues all to which the Grecians are most prompt and pregnant. But I can tell that in each grace of these, there lurks a still and dumb discursive devil that tempts most cunningly. But be not tempted.
Do you think I will?
No. But something may be done that we will not. And sometimes we are devils to ourselves when we will tempt the frailty of our powers, presuming on their changeful potency.
Nay, good, my lord.
Come, kiss, and let us part.
Brother Troilus!
Good brother, come you hither, and bring Aeneas and the Grecian with you.
My lord, will you be true?
Why? Alas, it is my vice, my fault. While others fished with craft for great opinion, I with great truth catch mere simplicity. While some with cunning gild their copper crowns, with truth and plainness I do wear mine bare. Fear not my truth. The moral of my wit is plain and true. There's all the reach of it. Welcome, Sir Diomed. Here is the lady which for Antenor we deliver you. At the port, lord, I'll give her to thy hand, and by the way possess thee what she is. Entreat her fair. And by my soul, fair Greek, if e'er thou stand at mercy of my sword, name Cressid, and thy life shall be as safe as Priam is in Ilion.
Fair Lady Cressid, so please you, save the thanks this prince expects. The luster in your eye, heaven in your cheek, pleads your fair usage. And to Diomed you shall be mistress, and command him wholly.
Grecian, thou dost not use me courteously to shame the zeal of my petition to thee in praising her. I tell thee, Lord of Greece, she is as far high soaring o'er thy praises as thou unworthy to be called her servant. I charge thee use her well, even for my charge. For by the dreadful Pluto, if thou dost not, though the great bulk Achilles be thy guard, I'll cut thy throat.
Oh, be not moved, Prince Troilus. Let me be privileged by my place and message to be a speaker free. When I am hence, I'll answer to my lust. And know you, lord, I'll nothing do on charge. To her own worth she shall be prized. But that you say, be it so, I'll speak it in my spirit and honor, no.
Come to the port. I tell thee, Diomed, this brave shall oft make thee to hide thy head. Lady, give me your hand. And as we walk to our own selves, then we are needful talk.
Hark! Hector's trumpet!
How have we spent this morning?
The prince must think me tardy and remiss that swore to ride before him to the field.
It is Troilus' fault. Come, come to field with him.
Let us make ready straight.
Yea, with a bridegroom's fresh alacrity. Let us address to tend on Hector's heels. The glory of our Troy doth this day lie on his fair worth and single chivalry.
art thou in appointment fresh and fair, anticipating time with starting courage. Give with thy trumpet a loud note to Troy, thou dreadful Ajax, that the appalled air may pierce the head of the great combatant and hail him hither.
Thou trumpet, where's my purse? Now crack thy lungs and split thy brazen pipe. Blow, villain, till thy sphered bias cheek outswell the collar of puffed Aquilon. Come, stretch thy chest and let thy eyes spout blood. Thou blowst for Hector.
No trumpet answers.
'Tis but early days.
Is not yon Diomed with Calchas' daughter?
'Tis he. I ken the manner of his gait. He rises on the toe. That spirit of his in aspiration lifts him from the earth.
Is this the Lady Cressida?
Even she.
Most dearly welcome to the Greeks, sweet lady.
Our general doth salute you with a kiss.
Yet is the kindness but particular. 'Twere better she were kissed in general.
And very courtly counsel. I'll begin. So much for Nestor.
I'll take that winter from your lips, fair lady. Achilles bids you welcome. I had good argument for kissing once.
But that's no argument for kissing now. For thus popped Paris in his hardiment, and parted thus you and your argument.
Oh, deadly gall, and theme of all our scorns, for which we lose our heads to gild his horns.
The first was Menelaus' kiss, this mine. Patroclus kisses you.
Oh, this is trim!
Paris and I kiss evermore for him.
I'll have my kiss, sir. Lady, by your leave.
In kissing, do you render or receive?
Both take and give.
I'll make my match to live. The kiss you take is better than you give. Therefore, no kiss.
I'll give you boot. I'll give you three for one.
You're an odd man. Give even or give none.
An odd man, lady? Every man is odd.
No, Paris is not. For you know, 'tis true that you are odd and he is even with you.
You fillip me on the head.
No, I'll be sworn.
It were no match, your nail against his horn. May I, sweet lady, beg a kiss of you?
You may.
I do desire it.
Why beg, then?
Why then, for Venus' sake, give me a kiss when Helen is a maid again, and his.
I am your debtor. Claim it when 'tis due.
Never's my day, and then a kiss of you.
Lady, a word. I'll bring you to your father.
A woman of quick sense.
Fie, fie upon her. There's language in her eye, her cheek, her lip. Nay, her foot speaks. Her wanton spirits look out at every joint and motive of her body. Oh, these encounterers so glib of tongue, that give a costing welcome ere it comes, and wide unclasp the tables of their thoughts to every tickling reader, set them down for sluttish spoils of opportunity and daughters of the game. The Trojans,
come!
Yonder comes the troop.
Hail, all the state of Greece! What shall be done to him that victory commands? Or do you purpose a victor shall be known? Will you the knights shall to the edge of all extremity pursue each other? Or shall they be divided by any voice or order of the field? Hector bade ask.
Which way would Hector have it?
He cares not. He'll obey condition.
'Tis done like Hector.
But securely done. A little proudly, and great deal misprizing the knight opposed.
If not Achilles, sir, what is your name?
If not Achilles, nothing.
Therefore Achilles. But whate'er, know this. In the extremity of great and little, valor and pride excel themselves in Hector. The one almost as infinite as all. The other blank as nothing. Weigh him well. And that which looks like pride is courtesy. This Ajax is half made of Hector's blood. In love whereof, half Hector stays at home. Half heart, half hand, half Hector comes to seek this blended knight, half Trojan and half Greek.
A maiden battle, then. Oh, I perceive you.
Here is Sir Diomed. Go, gentle knight, stand by our Ajax. As you and Lord Aeneas consent upon the order of their fight, so be it, either to the uttermost, or else of breath. The combatants being kin, half stints their strife before their strokes begin.
They are opposed already.
What Trojan is that same that looks so heavy?
The youngest son of Priam, a true knight. Not yet mature, yet matchless firm of word, speaking in deeds and deedless in his tongue. Not soon provoked, nor being provoked, soon calm. His heart and hand, both open and both free. For what he has, he gives. What thinks, he shows. Yet gives he not till judgment guide his bounty, nor dignifies an impair thought with bread. Manly as Hector, but more dangerous. For Hector, in his blaze of wrath, subscribes to tender objects. But he, in heat of action, is more vindicative than jealous love. They call him Troilus, and on him erect a second hope, as fairly built as Hector. Thus says Aeneas, one that knows the youth even to his inches, and with private soul did in great Ilion thus translate him to me.
They are in action.
Now, Ajax, hold my nose.
Hector! Hector, thou sleepest, awake thee.
Blows are well disposed. They are, Ajax.
You must know more.
Prince is enough, so please you.
I am not warm yet. Let us fight again.
As Hector pleases.
Why then will I know more? Thou art, great lord, my father's sister's son, a cousin german to great Priam's seed. The obligation of our blood forbids a gory emulation twixt us twain. Were thy commixion Greek and Trojan, so that thou couldst say, this hand is Grecian all and this is Trojan, the sinews of this leg all Greek and this all Troy, my mother's blood runs on the dexter cheek and this sinister bounds in my father's. By Jove, multipotent, thou shouldst not bear from me a Greekish member, wherein my sword had not impressure made of our rank feud. But the just gods gainsay that any drop thou borrowedst from thy mother, my sacred aunt, should by my mortal sword be drained. Let me embrace thee, Ajax. By him that thunders, thou hast lusty arms. Hector would have them fall upon him thus. Cousin, all honor to thee.
I thank thee, Hector. Thou art too gentle and too free a man. I came to kill thee, cousin, and bear hence a great addition earned in thy death.
Not Neoptolemus so mirable, on whose bright crest fame with her loudest oyes cries, this is he, could promise to himself a thought of added honor torn from Hector.
There is expectance here from both the sides what further you will do.
We'll answer it. The issue is embracement. Ajax, farewell.
If I might in entreaties find success, as seld I have the chance, I would desire my famous cousin to our Grecian tents.
'Tis Agamemnon's wish, and great Achilles doth long to see unarmed the valiant Hector.
Aeneas, call my brother Troilus to me, and signify this loving interview to the expectors of our Trojan part. Desire them home. Give me thy hand, my cousin. I will go eat with thee and see your knights.
Great Agamemnon comes to meet us here.
The worthiest of them tell me name by name. But for Achilles, my own searching eyes shall find him by his large and portly size.
Worthy of arms, as welcome as to one that would be rid of such an enemy. But that's no welcome. Understand more clear. What's past and what's to come is strewed with husks and formless ruin of oblivion. But in this extant moment, faith and troth, strained purely from all hollow bias drawing, bids thee with most divine integrity, from heart of very heart, great Hector, welcome.
I thank thee, most imperious Agamemnon.
My well-famed lord of Troy, no less to you.
Let me confirm my princely brother's greeting. You brace of warlike brothers, welcome hither.
Who must we answer?
The noble Menelaus.
Oh, you, my lord. By Mars, his gauntlet, thanks. Mock not that I affect the untraded oath. Your quondam wife swears still by Venus' glove. She's well, but bade me not commend her to you.
Name her not now, sir. She's a deadly thief.
Oh, pardon, I offend.
I have, thou gallant Trojan, seen thee oft, laboring for destiny, make cruel way through ranks of Greekish youth. And I have seen thee, as hot as Perseus, spur thy Phrygian steed, and seen thee scorning forfeits and subduments, when thou hast hung thy advanced sword in the air, not letting it decline on the declined. That I have said to some misstanders by, lo, Jupiter is yonder, dealing life. And I have seen thee pause and take thy breath when that a ring of Greeks have hemmed thee in like an Olympian wrestling. This have I seen, but this thy countenance still locked in steel I never saw till now. I knew thy grandsire, and once fought with him, he was a soldier good. But by great Mars, the captain of us all, never like thee. Oh, let an old man embrace thee, and worthy warrior, welcome to our tents.
'Tis the old Nestor.
Let me embrace thee, good old chronicle, that hast so long walked hand in hand with time. Most reverend Nestor, I am glad to clasp thee.
I would my arms could match thee in contention as they contend with thee in courtesy.
I would they could.
By this white beard, I'd fight with thee tomorrow. Well, welcome, welcome. I have seen the time.
I wonder now how yonder city stands, when we have here her base and pillar by us.
I know your favor, Lord Ulysses, well. Ah, sir, there's many a Greek and Trojan dead since first I saw yourself and Diomed in Ilion on your Greekish embassy.
Sir, I foretold you then what would ensue. My prophecy is but half his journey yet. For yonder walls that pertly front your town, yon towers whose wanton tops to bust the clouds, must kiss their own feet.
I must not believe you. There they stand yet. And modestly, I think the fall of every Phrygian stone will cost a drop of Grecian blood. The end crowns all, and that old common arbitrator, time, will one day end it.
So to him, we leave it. Most gentle and most valiant Hector, welcome. After the general, I beseech you next to feast with me and see me at my tent.
I shall forestall thee, Lord Ulysses.
Thou!
Now, Hector, I have fed mine eyes on thee. I have with exact view perused thee, Hector, and quoted joint by joint.
Is this Achilles?
I am. Achilles!
Stand fair, I pray thee, let me look on thee.
Behold thy fill.
Nay, I have done already.
Thou art too brief. I will the second time, as I would buy thee, View thee limb by limb.
Oh, like a book of sport thou'lt read me o'er. But there's more in me than thou understandst. Why dost thou so oppress me with thine eye?
Tell me, you heavens, in which part of his body shall I destroy him? Whether there, or there, or there, that I may give the local wound a name, and make distinct the very breach whereout Hector's great spirit flew. Answer me, heavens!
It would discredit the blessed gods, proud man, to answer such a question. Stand again. Think'st thou to catch my life so pleasantly as to prenominate in nice conjecture where thou wilt hit me dead?
I tell thee yea.
Wert thou an oracle to tell me so, I'd not believe thee. Henceforth, guard thee well, for I'll not kill thee there, nor there, nor there. But by the forge that stithied Mars his helm, I'll kill thee everywhere, yea, o'er and o'er. You wisest Grecians, pardon me this brag. His insolence draws folly from my lips. But I'll endeavor deeds to match these words, or may I never...
Do not chafe thee, cousin. You, Achilles, let these threats alone till accident or purpose bring you to it. You may have every day enough of Hector, if you have stomach. The general state, I fear, can scarce entreat you to be on with him.
I pray you, let us see you in the field. We have had pelting wars since you refused the Grecians' cause.
Dost thou entreat me, Hector? Tomorrow do I meet thee, hell as death. Tonight, all friends.
Thy hand upon that match.
First, all you peers of Greece, go to my tent. There, in the full, convive we. Afterwards, as Hector's leisure and your bounty shall concur together, severally entreat him. Beat loud the tabarins, let the trumpets blow, that this great soldier may his welcome know.
My lord Ulysses, tell me, I beseech you, in what place of the field doth Calchas keep?
At Menelaus' tent, most princely Troilus. Fair Diomed doth feast with him tonight, who neither looks upon the heaven nor earth, but gives all gaze and bent of amorous view on the fair Cressid.
Shall I, sweet lord, be bound to you so much after we part from Agamemnon's tent to bring me thither?
You shall command me, sir. As gentle, tell me, of what honor was this Cressida in Troy? Had she no lover there that wails her absence?
Oh, sir, to such as boasting show their scars, a mock is due. Will you walk on, my lord? She was beloved, she loved, she is and doth. But still sweet love is food for fortune.
Heat his blood with Greekish wine tonight, which with my scimitar I'll cool tomorrow. Patroclus, let us feast him to the height.
Here comes Thersites.
How now, thou core of envy, thou crusty batch of nature, what's the news?
Why, thou picture of what thou seemest, and idol of idiot worshipper. Here's the letter for thee.
From whence, fragment?
Why, thou full dish of fool, from Troy.
Who keeps the tent now?
The surgeon's box or the patient's wound.
Well said, adversity. And what need these tricks?
Prithee be silent, boy. I profit not by thy talk. Thou art thought to be Achilles' male varlet.
Male varlet, you rogue? What's that?
Why, his masculine horn.
breezes of the south, the guts griping, ruptures, catarrhs, loads of gravel in the back, lethargies, cold pulses, raw eyes, dirt, rotten livers, wheezing lungs, bladders full of imposium, sciaticas, lime kilns in the palm, incurable bonic, and the rivaled fee simple of the tetter. Take and take again such preposterous discovery.
Why, thou damnable box of envy, thou, what meanst thou to curse thus?
Do I curse?
Why, no, you ruinous, but you whoreson indistinguishable cur, no!
No? Why art thou then exasperate, thou idle, immaterial skein of sleeve silk, thou green sarsenet flap for a sore eye, thou tassel of a prodigal's purse, thou? Ah, how the poor world is pestered with such waterflies, diminutives of nature.
Out, Gaul!
Finch egg.
My sweet Patroclus, I am thwarted quite from my great purpose in tomorrow's battle. Here is a letter from Queen Hecuba, a token from her daughter, my fair love, both taxing me and gauging me to keep an oath that I have sworn. I will not break it. All Greeks, fail fame, honor or go or stay. My major vow lies here, this I'll obey. Come, come, Thersites, help to trim my tent. This night in banqueting must all be spent. Away, Patroclus!
With too much blood and too little brain, these two may run mad. But if with too much brain and too little blood they do, I'll be the curer of madmen. Here's Agamemnon. Oh, an honest fellow enough and one that loves quails. But he has not so much brain as earwax. And the goodly transformation of Jupiter there, his brother, the bull, the primitive statue and oblique memorial of cuckolds, a thrifty shoeing horn in a chain hanging at his brother's leg. To what form but that he is? Should wit larded with malice and malice forced with wit turn him to? To an ass were nothing, he is both ass and ox. To an ox were nothing, he is both ox and ass. To be a dog, a mule, a cat, a fitchu, a toad, a lizard, an owl, a puttock, or a herring without a roe, I would not care. But to be many lails, I would conspire against destiny. Ask me not what I would be if I were not Thersites, for I care not to be the louse of a lazar, so I were not Menelaus. Hide, spirits and fires.
We go wrong, we go wrong.
No, yonder 'tis, there where we see the lights.
I trouble you.
No, not a whit.
Here comes himself to guide you.
Welcome, brave Hector. Welcome, princes all.
So now, fair Prince of Troy, I bid good night. Ajax commands the guard to tend on you.
Thanks, and good night to the Greeks general.
Good night, my lord.
Good night, sweet Lord Menelaus.
Sweet draught, sweet quaffer, sweet sink, sweet silver.
Good night and welcome, both at once, to those that go or tarry.
Good night.
Old Nestor tarries, and you too, Diomed. Keep Hector company an hour or two.
I cannot, lord. I have important business, the tide whereof is now. Good night, great Hector.
Give me your hand.
Follow his torch. He goes to Calchas' tent. I'll keep you company.
Sweet sir, you honor me. And so, good night.
Come, come, enter my tent.
That same Diomed, a false-hearted rogue, a most unjust knave. I will no more trust him when he leers than I will a serpent when he hisses. He will spend his mouth and promise like Brabler the hound. But when he performs, astronomers foretell it is prodigious, they will come some change. The sun borrows of the moon when Diomed keeps his word. I will rather leave to see Hector than not to dog him. They say he keeps a Trojan drab and uses the traitor Calchas' his tent. I laughter. Nothing but let. All incontinent varlets!
What, are you up here, ho? Speak.
Who calls?
Diomed. Calchas, I think. Where's your daughter?
She comes to you.
Stand where the torch may not discover us. Cressid comes forth to him.
Oh, now, my charge.
Now, my sweet guardian. Hark, a word with you.
Yea, so familiar.
She will sing any man at first sight.
And any man may sing her if he can take her clef. She's noted.
Will you remember?
Remember?
yes.
Nay, but do then. And let your mind be coupled with your words.
What should she remember?
This.
Sweet honey, Greek, tempt me no more to folly.
Roguery.
Mary.
I'll tell you what.
Oh, come tell a pin. You are forsworn.
If faith, I cannot. What would you have me do?
A juggling trick to be secretly open.
What did you swear you would bestow on me?
I prithee do not hold me to mine oath. Bid me do anything but that sweet Greek.
Good night.
Hold patience.
How now, Trojan?
Die, O
no,
maid.
No, good night. I'll be your fool no more.
Thy better must.
Hark. One word in your ear.
Oh, plague and madness.
You are moved, Prince. Let us depart, I pray you. Lest your displeasure should enlarge itself to wrathful terms. This place is dangerous, the time right deadly. I beseech you, go.
Behold, I pray you.
Nay, good my lord, go off. You flow to great distraction. Come, my lord.
I pray thee, stay.
You have not patience. Come.
I pray you, stay. By hell and all hell's torments, I will not speak a word.
And so, good night.
Nay, but you part in anger.
Doth that grieve thee? Oh, withered truth.
Why, how now, lord?
By Jove, I will be patient.
Guardian. Why grieve?
Adieu, you palt.
In faith, I do not. Come hither once again.
You shake, my lord, at something. Will you go? You will break out.
She strokes his cheek.
Come, come.
Nay, stay. By Jove, I will not speak a word. There is between my will and all offences a guard of patience. Stay a little while.
How the devil lacks him with his fat rump and potato finger tickles these together.
But will you then?
In faith I will, La. Never trust me else.
Give me some token for the surety of it.
I'll fetch you one.
You have sworn patience.
Fear me not, sweet lord. I will not be myself, nor have cognition of what I feel. I am all patience.
Now the pledge. Now.
Here, Diomed, keep this sleeve.
Oh, beauty, where is thy faith?
My lord.
I will be patient. Outwardly, I will.
You look upon that sleeve. Behold it well. He loved me. Oh, false wench, give me again.
Whose was?
It is no matter now I have to gain. I will not meet with you tomorrow night. I prithee, Diomed, visit me no more.
Now she sharpens. Well said, whetstone.
I shall have it.
What, this?
Aye, that.
Oh, all you gods. Oh, pretty, pretty pledge. Thy master now lies thinking in his bed of thee and me, and sighs, and takes my glove, and gives memorial dainty kisses to it, as I kiss thee. Nay, do not snatch it from me. He that takes that doth take my heart withal.
I had your heart before. This follows it.
I did swear patience.
You shall not have it, Diomed. Faith, you shall not. I give you something else.
I will have this. Whose was it?
It is no matter.
Come, tell me whose it was.
It was one that's loved me better than you will. But now you have it, take it.
Whose was it?
By all Diana's waiting women yonder, and by herself, I will not tell you whose.
Tomorrow will I wear it on my helm, and grieve his spirit that dares not challenge it.
Wert thou the devil and wast it on my horn, it should be challenged.
Well, it is done, it is past, and yet it is not. I will not keep my word.
Why then, farewell. Thou never shalt mock Diomed again.
You shall not go. One cannot speak a word, but it straight starts you.
I do not like this fooling.
Nor I, by Pluto. But that likes not you pleases me best.
What? Shall I come? The hour.
I come. Oh, Jove, do come. I shall be plagued.
Farewell till then.
Good night, I prithee, God. Troilus, farewell. One eye yet looks on thee. But with my heart, the other eye doth see. Ah, poor our sex, this fault in us I find. The error of our eye directs our mind. What error leaves must err. Oh, then conclude, minds swayed by eyes are full of turpitude.
A proof of strength she could not publish more, unless she say, my mind.
is now turned wrong.
All's done, my lord.
It is.
Why stay we then?
To make a recordation to my soul of every syllable that here was spoken. But if I tell how these two did coact, shall I not lie in publishing a truth? Sith there is yet a credence in my heart, an esperance so obstinately strong that doth invert the test of eyes and ears, as if those organs had deceptious functions created only to calumniate. Was Cressid here?
I cannot conjure, Trojan.
She was not sure.
Most sure she was.
Why, my negation hath no taste of madness.
Nor mine, my lord. Cressid was here, but not.
Let it not be believed for womanhood. Think we had mothers. Do not give advantage to stubborn critics, apt without a theme for deprivation, to square the general sex by Cressid's rule. Rather think this not Cressid.
What hath she done, prince, that can soil our mother?
Nothing at all. Unless that this were she.
Will a swagger himself out on his own eyes?
This she? No. This is Diomed's Cressida. If beauty have a soul, this is not she. If souls guide vows, if vows be sanctimonies, if sanctimony be the god's delight, if there be rule in unity itself, this is not she. Madness of discourse, that cause sets up with and against itself. Bifold authority, where reason can revolt without perdition, and loss assume all reason without revolt. This is and is not Cressid. Within my soul, there doth conduce a fight of this strange nature, that a thing in separate divides more wider than the sky and earth. And yet the spacious breadth of this division admits no RFX for a point as subtle as Ariadne's broken woof to enter. Instance, oh instance, strong as Pluto's gates, Cressid is mine, tied with the bonds of heaven. Instance, oh instance, strong as heaven itself, the bonds of heaven are slipped, dissolved and loosed, and with another knot, five-finger tied, the fractions of her faith, aughts of her love, the fragments, scraps, the bits and greasy relics of her o'er-eaten faith are given to Diomed.
May worthy Troilus be but half attached with that which here his passion doth express.
Aye, Greek, and that shall be divulged well in characters as red as Mars, his heart inflamed with Venus. Never did young man fancy with so eternal and so fixed a soul. Hark, Greek. As much as I do Cressid love, so much by weight hate I her Diomed. That sleeve is mine that he'll bear on his helm. Were it a cask composed by Vulcan's skill, my sword should bite it. Not the dreadful spout which shipmen do the hurricane call, constringed in mass by the almighty sun, shall dizzy with more clamor Neptune's ear in his descent, than shall my prompted sword falling on Diomed.
He'll tickle it for his concubine.
Oh, Cressid. Oh. False, Cressid. False. 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 Let all untrue stand by thy stained name, and they'll seem glorious.
Oh, contain yourself. Your passion draws ears hither.
I have been seeking you this hour, my lord. Hector by this is arming him in Troy. Ajax, your guard, stays to conduct you home.
Have with you, prince. My courteous lord, adieu. Farewell, revolted fair. And Diomed, stand fast and wear a castle on thy head.
I'll bring you to the gates.
Accept distracted thanks.
Would I could meet that rogue Diomed. I would croak like a raven. I would boast. Patroclus will give me anything for the intelligence of this whore. The parrot will not do more for an almond than he for a commodious drab. Lechery. Still wars and lechery. Nothing else holds fashion. A burning devil take them.
When was my lord so much ungently tempered to stop his ears against admonishment? Unarm, unarm, and do not fight today.
You train me to offend you. Get you in. By all the everlasting gods, I'll go.
My dreams will sure prove ominous to the day.
No more, I say.
Where is my brother Hector?
Here, sister. Armed and bloody in intent. Consort with me in loud and dear petition. Pursue we him on knees. For I have dreamed of bloody turbulence, and this whole night hath nothing been but shapes and forms of slaughter.
Oh, 'tis true.
Ho! Bid my trumpet sound!
No notes of Sally for the heavens, sweet brother.
Be gone, I say. The gods have heard me swear.
The gods are deaf to hot and peevish vows. They are polluted offerings, more abhorred than spotted livers in the sacrifice.
Oh, be persuaded. Do not count it holy to hurt by being just. It is as lawful, for we would give much, to use violent thefts and rob in the behalf of charity.
It is the purpose that makes strong the vow, but vows to every purpose must not hold. Unarmed, sweet Hector.
Hold you still, I say. Mine honor keeps the weather of my fate. Life every man holds dear, but the dear man holds honor far more precious dear than life. How now, young man? Meanst thou to fight today?
Cassandra, call my father to persuade.
No faith, young Troilus. Doff thy harness, youth. I am today the vein of chivalry. Let grow thy sinews till their knots be strong, and tempt not yet the brushes of the war. Unarm thee, go! And doubt thou not, brave boy, I'll stand today for thee and me, and Troy!
Brother, you have a vice of mercy in you, which better fits a lion than a man.
What vice is that? Good Troilus, chide me for it.
When many times the captive Grecian falls, even in the fan and win of your fair sword, you bid them rise and live.
Oh, 'tis fair play.
Fool's play, by heaven, Hector.
How now, how now?
For the love of all the gods, let's leave the hermit pity with our mother. And when we have our armors buckled on, the venom and vengeance ride upon our swords. Spur them to ruthful work, rein them from ruth.
Fie, savage, fie.
Hector, then 'tis war.
Troilus, I would not have you fight today.
Who should withhold me? Not fate, obedience, nor the hand of Mars beckoning with fiery truncheon my retire. Not Priamus and Hecuba on knees, their eyes o'ergalled with recourse of tears. Nor you, my brother, with your true sword drawn, opposed to hinder me, should stop my way, but by my ruin.
Lay hold upon him, Priam, hold him fast. He is thy crutch. Now if thou lose thy stay, thou on him leaning and all Troy on thee, fall altogether.
Come, Hector, come. Go back. Thy wife hath dreamed. Thy mother hath had visions. Cassandra doth foresee. And I myself am like a prophet, suddenly enwrapped, to tell thee that this day is ominous. Therefore, come back.
Aeneas is afield, and I do stand engaged to many Greeks, even in the faith of valor, to appear this morning to them.
Aye, but thou shalt not go.
I must not break my faith. You know me dutiful. Therefore, dear sir, let me not shame respect, but give me leave to take that course by your consent and voice which you do here forbid me, royal Priam.
Oh, Priam, yield not to him.
Do not, dear father.
Andromache, I am offended with you. Upon the love you bear me, get you in.
This foolish, dreaming, superstitious girl makes all these bodements.
Oh, farewell, dear Hector. Look how thou diest. Look how thine eye turns pale. Look how thy wounds do bleed at many vents. Hark how Troy roars, how Hecuba cries out, how poor Andromache shrills her dolors forth. Behold distraction, frenzy, and amazement, like witless antics one another meet, and all cry, Hector! Hector's dead! Oh, Hector!
Away, away!
Farewell! Live soft. Hector, I take my leave. Thou dost thyself and all our Troy deceive.
You are amazed, my liege, at her exclaims. Go in and cheer the town. Wheel forth and fight. Do deeds worth praise and tell you them at night.
farewell. The gods with safety stand above thee.
They are at it. Hark! Thou Diomed, believe I come to lose my arm or win my sleeve.
Do you hear, my lord? Do you hear?
What now?
Here's a letter come from yon poor gal.
Let me read.
A horse and tissic. A horse and rascally tissic so troubles me. And the foolish fortune of this girl. And what one thing, what another. But I shall leave you one of these days. And I have a rheum in mine eyes, too. And such an ache in my bones that unless a man were cursed, I cannot tell what to think on't. What says she there?
Words. Words. Mere words. No matter from the heart. The effect doth operate another way. Go, wind, to wind. There turn and change together. My love with words and errors still she feeds, but edifies another with her deeds.
Now they are clapper clawing one another. I'll go look on. That dissembling abominable varlet, Diomed, has got that same scurvy, doting, foolish young knave's sleeve of Troy there in his helm. I would fain see them meet. But that same young Trojan ass that loves the whore there might send that Greekish, whoremasterly villain with the sleeve back to the dissembling luxurious drab of the sleeveless errand. But t'other side, the policy of those crafty swearing rascals, that stale, old, mouse-eaten, dry cheese Nestor, and that same dog fox Ulysses, is not proved worth a blackberry. They set me up in policy, that mongrel cur, Ajax, against the dog of his better kind, Achilles. And now is the cur, Ajax, prouder than the cur, Achilles, and will not arm today. Whereupon the Grecians begin to proclaim barbarism, and policy grows into an ill opinion. Soft, here comes Sleeve and T'other.
Fly not! Shouldst thou take the river Styx, I would swim after!
Thou dost this call retire, I do not fly. But advantageous care withdrew me from the odds of multitude.
Have it thee!
Hold thy whore, Grecian! Now for thy whore, Trojan! Now the sleeve, now the sleeve!
What art thou, Greek? Art thou for Hector's match? Art thou of blood and honor?
No, 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 no. I am a rascal, a scurvy, railing knight, a very guilty one.
I do believe thee. Live!
God, have mercy that thou wilt believe me. But a plague break thy neck for frighting me. What's become of the wenching robes? I think they have swallowed one another. I would laugh at that miracle. Yet in a sort, lechery eats itself. I'll seek him.
Go, go, my servant. Take thou Troilus' horse. Present the fair steed to my lady Cressid. Fellow, commend my service to her beauty. Tell her I have chastised the amorous Trojan and am her knight by proof.
I go, my lord.
Renew, renew. The fierce Polydamas hath beat down Menon. Bastard Margarilon hath Doria's prisoner, and stands Colossus-wise waving his beam upon the pashid corpses of the kings Epistrophus and Cedius. Polixenes is slain, Amphimachus and Thoas deadly hurt, Patroclus ta'en or slain, and Palamedes sore hurt and bruised. The dreadful Sagittary appalls our numbers. Haste we, Diomed, to reinforcement, or we perish all! Bear Patroclus' body to Achilles, and bid the snail-paced Ajax arm for shame. There is 1,000 Hectors in the field. Now here he fights on Galathee, his horse, and there lacks work. Anon he's then put
and there they fly or die like scaled skulls before the belching whale. Then is he yonder, and there the strawy Greeks, ripe for his edge, fall down before him like a mower's swathe. Here, there, and everywhere he leaves and takes, dexterity so obeying appetite that what he will he does, and does so much that proof is called impossibility.
Oh, courage, courage, princes! Wait, Achilles is armed, weeping, cursing, vowing vengeance. Patroclus' wounds have roused his drowsy blood. Together with his mangled myrmidons, that knows this hand is hacked and chipped, come to him crying on Hector. Ajax has lost a friend and foams at mouth, and he's armed and at it, roaring for Troilus, who hath done today mad and fantastic execution, engaging and redeeming of himself with such a careless force and forthless care, as if that luck in very spite of cunning bade him win all.
Troilus! Of coward Troilus!
Aye, there, there.
So we draw together.
Where is this Hector? Come, come, thou boy-colour. Show me thy face. Know what it is to meet Achilles, angry. Hector, where's Hector? I will none but Hector.
Troilus, thou coward Troilus, show thy head.
Troilus, I say, where's Troilus?
What wouldst thou?
I would correct him.
Were I the general, thou shouldst have my office there that correction.
Troilus, I say! What?
Troilus!
Oh, traitor Diomed! Turn my false face, thou traitor, and pay thine life thou owest me for my horse.
Art thou there?
I'll fight you them alone. Stand, Diomed.
Give my prize. I will not look upon.
Come, both you cogging Greeks. Have it, you both! Yea, Troilus! Oh, well fought, my youngest brother.
Now do I see thee. Ah, have at thee, Hector!
Horse, if thou wilt. I do disdain thy courtesy, proud Trojan. Be happy that my arms are out of use. My rest and negligence befriends thee now. But thou anon shalt hear of me again. Till when, go seek thy fortune.
Fare thee well. I would have been much more a fresher man had I expected thee. How now, my brother?
Ajax hath taken Aeneas. Shall it be? Oh, by the flame of yonder glorious heaven, he shall not carry him. I'll be tame too, or bring him off. Fate, hear me what I say. I reck not, though I end my life today.
Stand, stand, thou Greek. Thou art a goodly mark. No, would thou not?
I like thy armor well. I'll thrush it and unlock the rivets all, but I'll be master of it.
Would thou not, beast, abide? Why then, fly on. I'll hunt thee for thy hide.
Come here about me, you my myrmidons. Mark what I say. Attend me where I will. Strike not a stroke, but keep yourselves in breath. And when I have the bloody Hector found, impale him with your weapons round about. In fellest manner execute your arms. Follow me, sirs, and my proceedings aye. It is decreed Hector the Great must die.
The cuckold and the cuckold maker are at it.
Now, bull, now, dog. Loo, Paris, loo. Now my doubled horns start him. Loo, Paris, loo. The bull has the game. Where horns? Oh.
Turn, slave, and fight.
What's art thou?
A bastard son of Priam.
Oh, well, I am a bastard, too. I love bastards. I am a bastard begot, bastard instructed, bastard in mind, bastard in valor, in everything illegitimate. One bear will not bite another. Take heed!
The quarrel's most ominous to us. If the son of a whore fights for a whore, he tempts judgments. Farewell, bastard!
The devil take thee, coward!
Most putrefied core, so fare without
Thy goodly armor thus hath cost thy life. Now is my day's work done. I'll take good breath. Rest, sword. Thou hast thy fill of blood and death.
Look, Hector, how the sun begins to set. How ugly night comes breathing at his heels. Even with the veil and darking of the sun, to close the day up, Hector's life is done.
I am unarmed. Forgo this vantage, Greek.
Strike, fellows, strike! This is the man I seek. So, Ilion, fall thou next. Now, Troy, sink down. Here lies thy heart, thy sinews, and thy bone. On, Myrmidons, and cry all amain. Achilles hath the mighty Hector slain. Hark, a retire upon our Grecian part.
The Trojan trumpets sound the like, my lord.
The dragon wing of night o'erspreads the earth, and stickler-like the armies separates. My half-supped sword, that frankly would have fed, pleased with this dainty bait, thus goes to bed. Come, tie his body to my horse's tail. Along the field I will the Trojan trail.
What shout is that?
These drums.
Achilles! Achilles! Hector slain, Achilles!
The brute is Hector slain, and by Achilles.
If it be so, yet bragless let it be. Great Hector was as good a man as he.
March patiently along. Let one be sent to pray Achilles see us at our tent. If in his death the gods have us befriended, great Troy is ours, and our sharp wars are ended.
Stand ho! Yet are we masters of the field. Never go home. Here starve we out the night.
Hector is slain. He's dead. And of the murderer's horse's tail, in beastly sort dragged through the shameful field. Frown on, you heavens. Effect your rage with speed. Sit gods upon your thrones and smite at Troy. I say at once, let your brief plagues be mercy, and linger not our sure destructions on.
My lord, you do discomfort all the host.
You understand me not to tell me so. I do not speak of flight, of fear of death, but dare all imminence that gods and men address their dangers in. Hector is gone. Who shall tell Priam so, or Hecuba? Let him that will a screech owl eye be called, go into Troy and say there, Hector's dead. There is a word will Priam turn to stone, make wells and Niobes of the maids and wives, cold statues of the youth, and in a word, scare Troy out of itself. But march away. Hector is dead. There is no more.
Say it!
You vile, abominable tents, thus proudly pite upon our Phrygian plains, let Titan rise as early as he dare, I'll through and through you. And thou great-sized coward, no space of earth shall sunder our two hates, I'll haunt thee like a wicked conscience still, that moldeth goblins swift as frenzy's thoughts.
Strike a free march to Troy!
With comfort go. Hope of revenge shall hide our inward woe.
shame pursue thy life, and live I with thy name.
A goodly medicine for my aching bones. Oh, world, world, world. Thus is the poor agent despised. Oh, traders and bawds, how earnestly are you set to work, and how ill requited. Why should our endeavor be so desired, and the performance so loathed? What verse for it? What instance for it? Let me see. Full merrily the humble bee doth sing, till he hath lost his honey and his sting, and being once subdued in armed tail, sweet honey and sweet notes together fail. Good traders in the flesh, set this in your painted cloths. As many as be here of Pandar's hall, your eyes half out, weep out at Pandar's fall. Or if you cannot weep, yet give some groans, though not for me, yet for your aching bones. Brethren and sisters of the hold-or trade, some 2 months hence my will shall here be made. It should be now, but that my fear is this: some galled goose of Winchester would hiss. Till then, I'll sweat and seek about for eases, and at that time bequeath you my diseases.